Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Fred Waitzkin, has written The Dream Merchant. It's published by St. Martin's Press. Dream Merchant? No, it's not Hollywood. It's about the type of person who makes other people say, "Those are my dreams." And welcome, Fred.
It's delightful to be here with you today.
Thank you. And Dream Merchant is a man named Jim. And we learn about him through a man who is a newspaper reporter. And they meet in Bimini because they're both there fishing. And Jim says, "Well, I've got like a 100-foot yacht. I'm a big shot. My wife, Phyllis, and I, come with your wife, and we'll go fishing and sailing." And they do, but something happens, which is suddenly a clue. What is it?
Well, they meet on the south end of this tiny island, in a little shack called the End of the World Saloon. And the narrator, who is a journalist, wants to be by himself. He wants to think about the water, and he doesn't want to be bothered by this other man, this stranger, whom he's never met before. But this other man is so insistent and compelling and persuasive that he finds himself speaking intimately to him, and he finds himself revealing himself to this character, Jim, in a way that he would never have expected. And then, as you say, the fellow Jim, at the end of a long evening, makes a suggestion that they go out together on his yacht and spend 4 or 5 days. And they do this. They actually do this. The two couples, they go out. They have a long cruise. And the narrator, who knows the waters very well, directs them to an atoll, which is about 70 miles to the south of the island. It's a very luxurious boat. And they anchor for the evening. And they drink wine. They have wonderful conversations. They play gin rummy. And all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, they're talking on the aft deck, and this fellow, Jim, becomes very taut and dark. His whole manner changes. And he looks out into the darkness, and he says to the narrator, "Wait a minute." He goes below deck and comes back with two automatic rifles. And he hands one to Jim and one to himself, and he says, "Don't say a word." And soon, they hear the rumble of a speedboat closing in. And after a couple of minutes, they see the shape of two men in the companionway of the speedboat. And the narrator, who's a writer from New York and doesn't know anything about guns and drug smuggling, is terrified. Jim says, "Get on the deck." And before the narrator knows what happens, Jim has shot off 3 rounds of this automatic rifle, and the speedboat takes off. And Jim says, "We've got to be very careful because there's been a drug bust around here. Yeah. And we've got to defend ourselves. We've got to make it through the night." And so the narrator finds himself on the aft deck of the boat holding a rifle to try to guard the wives from whomever. Yeah. And meanwhile, this guy, Jim, tells him the story of his life. And that's how the book begins.
As he tells him the story, there are really... the characters, almost like a Fellini movie, they start to come out. And it begins with Phyllis, the wife. Then it turns out there was a gorgeous woman named Ava who was there in the beginning. But the person who was like the puppet master is a man named Marvin. Describe Marvin for our friends.
Well, let me back up a couple of beats before I get to Marvin. Jim is a super salesman. He can sell anything to anyone. He's the kind of guy that I think of him as the best friend you've ever had for as long as he's your friend.
Yeah.
That friendship might last for 3 months. It might last for 3 years. Then he walks away from you. But during those 3 months, you feel very privileged. He's a great salesman. He can sell anything to anyone. But he has visions of grandeur. He wants to really make it big. He doesn't want to make a little money. Yeah. He wants to make a lot of money. And he runs into this guy. His name is Marvin Gessler. And Marvin Gessler is a genius. Yeah. But he's also a kind of idiot savant.
He's also a pig.
And he's a pig. I mean,
yeah.
he's got filthy habits. You know, he spits in his hands. He touches himself. He does disgusting things. But he has brilliant ideas, really brilliant ideas. And Jim realizes that if he can kind of create this merger with Marvin, mm-hmm. where Jim is the outside guy, the guy that can sell the goods, and Marvin is the inside guy, the guy that comes up with amazing ideas, They can take it to the top. They can become fabulously wealthy.
What's interesting is Marvin is more of a long-range thinker than our friend Jim.
Yes.
Jim is right there at the hot. I'll sell it to you. I'll buy it for you. You're going to make a fortune. And he uses Ava, who is, I guess, his wife at that point. And she's an Ava Gardner type. She is beautiful. She is there. And she really just wants a simple life. Well, doesn't quite get the simple life, but they do start to make money. And he starts, but it is Marvin who thinks up the idea of making, like, well, what we have here, well, it's either Uncle Sam or it's what a brother so-and-so, these big, enormous selling places.
That's right. I mean, he really is the father of network marketing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he's if you think of them as a unit, which is how I think of them, Marvin and Jim, they're kind of precursors of Bernie Madoff.
Yeah.
They can sell you on the fact that you're about to make all the money that you could ever dream of. And you believe them because they're so compelling.
They even think up that in their department stores or whatever these stores are, they're going to hold a lottery.
Right.
And people buy their tickets.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have fantastic promotional ideas. And you mentioned Ava. Ava is a great character. She's one of the most important characters in the book. And I had an idea for Ava, but I didn't know how to create her. I wanted her to be like, the idea that I had behind her, Ava Gardner was one of the aspects of her being. But I also, if you recall, the girlfriend of Paul Newman in the movie The Hustler,
yeah,
who was played by Piper Laurie. She was very beautiful, but very tarnished, very wounded from life and love. And I wanted to create a character like that. But I'd never known such a woman. So at the suggestion of my son, who's a pretty smart guy, I hired an actress who was 26 years old and very beautiful. Her name was Maya. And I told her about the character that I wanted to create. And I remember the first time I met her, we were at a restaurant. And we talked for about an hour, and I described this character of Ava that I wanted to create. And all of a sudden, after about 45 minutes, Maya got up from the table. And her entire countenance darkened. And in a moment, she became Maya. She's a good actress. In a moment, she became Maya. For the next year, we worked together. I would send her emails, and I would tell her what Maya did, what Ava would do, because Ava goes to some very dark places in the book, as you know.
Yeah.
And we would block them out together, and that's how I created the character.
Then there is Phyllis, who is perfect on Madison Avenue in a great condo, and she really loves Jim.
All of the
women love Jim. He ends up, he's broke. He sells the condo. They're living in a one-bedroom apartment. And he decides he's going to go to the Amazon. And he has heard you can get gold there. That is a book in itself, Fred.
It's a book in itself.
Yeah. So they go there. He goes there. He gets involved. It's lucky he comes out with his life. And there are two women he's involved with. But he does come out with at least $1 million. He goes back to Florida. He loses the $1 million, but he has found a beautiful young girl in Israel who has fallen madly in love with his old man. And the reporter comes and can't get over this either.
Right. That's right.
And he is broke. He is broke. There is no, I mean, they're eating soup for dinner. And she has two sons. And before you know it, Jim has gotten back with his buddy Marvin, and they're in Cincinnati.
In a new business.
Yeah.
Making a lot of money.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's true. Well, all of that happens. But just to talk about Brazil a little bit, if you'd like to.
I'd love you to.
It took me 10 years to write the book. I'm a slow writer, but it took me 10 years to write this book. But actually, I was thinking about this book since 1984. 1984 was the year that I wrote Searching for Bobby Fischer. But during that same year, I read an article in Time magazine about how they mine for gold in the Amazon. And I'll describe it to your fans briefly. It's a very, very interesting story. They have these little lawless kingdoms called garimpos all throughout the rainforest. And what a garimpo is basically, it's a little, you know, let's say several acre community, as it were, or kingdom, I like to think of in the middle of the jungle. And in this little kingdom that's run by a guy that owns it, there is a cantina where food is served. There is a barracks where a militia lives, because each one of these garimpos needs to be defended by gunmen, because there are people from the outside that want to take it over to steal the gold.
This is tribalism in Afghanistan.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And also, there's a brothel, and there's beautiful women working in the brothel. Now, around the circumference of the garimpo, there are gold miners that are digging in the earth, let's say 700 or 800 or 1,000 of them, that are digging in holes, and they're extracting the gold out of the ground. And after a month, in their fantasy, they're going to take the gold and bring it back to the city and get their families out of poverty. But that never really happens, because what happens is, at the end of the month, they hear music emanating from the jungle, because big speakers in the garimpo send the music out into the jungle. They smell the delicious food. They come into the garimpo. They're attracted to the beautiful young women, and they spend the money that they earn for a month on the women and the food, and then they have to go out into the jungle and dig for gold again. And so it's kind of like the myth of Sisyphus. It goes on and on and on, and the only person that ever makes any money is the guy that owns the garimpo, or our man Jim.
Yeah.
So my idea in 1984 was that I was going to take Willie Loman and bring him into the jungle and have him meet Kurtz in the heart of darkness, in the jungle. That was my concept 30 years before I wrote the book.
Well, it's there, and as I said, Fred, unforgettable character. That is Jim, and you make him walk that he could walk in the room this minute. I thank you. Will you autograph my book?
I'd be delighted to.
And we'll be back after a short pause.